Drones is a movie about two Air Force personnel in a trailer in Nevada flying a drone over Afghanistan, half a world away. And they're on the trail of a guy who may or may not be a terrorist. And they're surveilling a compound in the mountains, which is owned by the guy's parents. And his kids are there, and they're putting up a banner that says, "Welcome," that says, "Happy birthday, Daddy." So they're pretty sure he's going to show up. But while they're waiting for him to show up, more and more friends and family show up. And pretty soon there's about 25 or 30 people there, including women and children and goats. And then this guy shows up. And there's the command, the U.S. command is saying, Army intelligence is saying, or Air Force intelligence is saying, he's a terrorist. But one of the two pilots says, this guy is not a terrorist, and I don't know why we're taking him out. And then the order comes down to launch a missile on the entire compound. So collateral damage, huge. And one of the pilots refuses. The film is about sort of the moral ambiguities of modern warfare and the human cost. It's not, it's anti-war the way Paths of Glory are anti-war. It was anti-war. It's a film that is not liberal, it's not conservative, it's not hawk, it's not dove. It's really about the costs of war and the human costs, and not only about the acknowledged victims, but also the unacknowledged victims, the guys who are now pushing the buttons, who are suffering an incredibly hard fate of PTSD. It's a really complex moral issue, and how one prevents terrorism, and do drone strikes prevent terrorism, or do they create even more terrorism? And that's a delicate balance. I mean, we're not talking about surgical strikes with no collateral damage, and when we get it wrong, we create more terrorists. So I'm neither, you know, pro drones nor anti drones. But I am very much in favor of really trying to figure it out and not acting with impunity from the damage that we're creating. What has happened is a deepening awareness of just how complex the issue is. And how, I mean, I guess to a degree it's made me a little bit more of an isolationist, that I think the United States really has to be aware of, you know, of boots on the ground. But here's a case where our American policy seems to be more and more like, you know, we can have influence, we can change events in foreign countries without putting boots on the ground and without risking American troops. And to a degree, that's true. But I think that there is a cost, and I think that cost isn't being looked at, and that's the psychological cost of the people who are waging warfare by remote control. You know, I think the film's an anti-war film like Paths of Glory, but I don't think it takes sides. The raising of awareness, though, is something that really is hopefully a byproduct of the film. First and foremost, I hope that we give you an experience that is tense, and in which you're constantly guessing what's going to happen next. But at the end of the day, I hope when you come out of the film, you're both a little shocked by what happened, and it makes you think. I'm hoping that what happens is at the end of the movie, you ask yourself the question, would I have pushed the button or wouldn't I have pushed the button? And if we can take you through that experience and make you really question, what would I do in that circumstance? I think the film's been successful. And what's fascinating to me is that when you poll an audience after the movie and you say, well, do you think the guy they were surveilling was a terrorist? The audience is really split. And even the guys who made the film with me, when you ask them, they're split. Some people say, yeah, oh, absolutely, he's a terrorist. And other people say, he's not a terrorist.
I have to ask you, though, you must have an opinion.
I don't think he was a terrorist, but so I have one opinion, but I mean, my cinematographer says absolutely he was a terrorist, and so I mean back and forth. And if you ask the actors who are playing the characters. It's interesting because Matt O'Leary, whose character is at first very much like we're just following orders, without giving anything away in the film, I think if you asked him, he would say, no, I don't think he actually was a terrorist. And I think Eloise Mumford would say, absolutely, he's a terrorist. I think what's really fascinating about the script is that there's a period of time in which the two characters actually shift radically their points of view. They flip. And we always thought that that was the most difficult moment in the film. When you have two characters who have taken a point of view all the way through the film, and then all of a sudden they cross. And if we couldn't pull it off, the film wasn't going to work. And if we could pull it off, the film was going to grab you and hold you even tighter.
What does it feel like for you as a director to be here having your film at the festival?
You know, right now I'm a little exhausted and a little jet lagged and a little stunned. I mean, I'm trying to figure it all out. I've never been to the BFI London Film Festival before. I've been to Sundance, and I've been to South by Southwest, and I've been to a number of other film festivals, but this is a first for me. So I'm really trying to figure out the lay of the land here.
And tell me, what was it that made your mind up to not make this story as a documentary?
It's interesting you ask that, because I started out in documentary films. Yep. And so I worked, my first job out of college was for the PBS station in New Hampshire. I had a really interesting experience as a documentarian. I was filming a woman, a painter, whose husband had died, and she was telling me a very sort of interesting personal story, and she began to weep. And I had the camera on my shoulder, and my finger was right here for the turning the camera on, and I couldn't turn the camera on. I felt it was such a violation of her intimacy. And that sort of was the beginning of my moving away from documentaries and into narrative fictional films, because I thought, wow, if I have that much trouble recording, sort of what's happening, how am I gonna become a documentary filmmaker? You know, I think I'm better suited to the narrative world only because that's where I think my skills have developed. I think about doing documentary films. I mean, there is a documentary that's sort of on deck that I have an English teacher. I went to an East Coast boarding school, and I have an English teacher that when I was 15 taught me creative writing, who's still teaching, and we're still in touch. And he just retired last year from coaching baseball. He's still teaching. So I've thought a lot about going back and doing a documentary about him and all of that. I mean, it's sort of a modern Mr. Chips, you know, the number of people whose lives he's touched in such a positive way. So there's a case of going back and maybe doing a documentary. But in terms of telling stories, for me, the ability to shape and draw you into a story, I think, for me, my skills are better served in the fictional world. You've got to go and see Drones because you'll be challenged and you'll be caught up in the film and you'll wonder at the end of the day, would you push the button or wouldn't you?